Good to see each of you here this morning, and it is time now to get started with our morning worship service. So if you'll grab a hymnal, please, stand with me and turn to page 214. Page 214. All together. I have a song that Jesus gave me. It was sent from heaven above. There never was a sweeter melody. 'Tis a melody of love. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody. Melody of love. I love the Christ who died on Calvary, for he washed my sins away. He put within my heart a melody, and I know it's there to stay. In my heart there rings a melody. Melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody of love. 'Twill be my endless theme in glory. With the angels I will sing. 'Twill be a song with glorious harmony. When the courts of heaven ring, in my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody of love.
Dear Heavenly Father, we do thank you for this opportunity to be in your house today, Lord.
Amen.
Just thank you, Lord, that you were willing to lay down your life for us, Lord, to pay our sin debt.
Amen.
Pray for all the people today, Lord, that are sick and can't be here. We pray that you would be with them.
Yes.
You would raise them up. For Michael and Evelyn, they might be traveling today, Lord, that you would just watch over them.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. We just pray for Pastor that you would fill him with your Spirit, Lord. And pray that you would give him the words to speak unto us, Lord. And pray that everybody here would listen closely to the words being spoken, Lord. And I pray, Lord, that everybody would get a blessing, Lord.
Yes.
From the words being spoken today, Lord. And I pray, Lord, that you would lead and guide and direct in the services today, Lord. And we ask all this in Jesus' name.
Amen. And you may be seated. Our next song this morning will be page 237. Page 237. All together. I wandered in the shades of night till Jesus came to me, and with the sunlight of his love did all my darkness flee. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. Sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of his love within. Though clouds may gather in the sky and billows round me roll, however dark the world may be, and sunlight in my soul. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. Sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of his love within. While walking in the light of God, my sweet communion find. I press with holy vigor on and leave the world behind. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. Sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of His love within. I cross the wide extended fields, I journey o'er the plain, and in the sunlight of His love I reap the golden grain. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. Sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of His love within. Soon I shall see Him as He is, the light that came to me. Behold the brightness of His face throughout eternity. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. Sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of His love within.
Bible study Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. The kids will be downstairs for their wanted groups at the same time. So if you're able to be here for that, we encourage you to be here. Also, the prayer list from this past Wednesday are on the back table. This Friday from noon until 1, we will have our lunch Bible study and fellowship. We're doing a video study that also has a booklet to fill in the blanks on called The Invisible War, talking about spiritual warfare, how to fight back against the lies of the devil that he often tries to bring into our lives. If you're able to be here for lunch, Bible study on Friday from noon to 1, we'll be right downstairs in the big classroom. Finally, later this month, on Wednesday night, October 28th, we'll have the Blanchards Missionaries to China, who will be joining us during the Wednesday night midweek service. So if you're able to be here for that, be in prayer for them. A lot of missionaries are starting now to kind of get back on the road and gain some support. It's still kind of tough sledding for a lot of them because a lot of churches aren't all the way open up yet, or they're very limited in what services they are offering. So we pray for the Blanchards that as they come to us, and this will be a good blessing to them that night. If no one's ready, he'll come forward now and receive the offering. As he comes, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Lord, we do just thank you for this beautiful day that you've given us, Lord.
Yes.
Just a beautiful fall here so far, Lord. We just thank you so much for it. We thank you for the opportunity to be in your house. We thank you for just the opportunity to see each other in the face today, Lord. Just to look at each other and encourage each other, Lord, to exalt your name. And I pray that as we do that today, as we sing to you, as we study your word, and even now as we get back a portion of what you've blessed us with, Lord, I pray you help us do it with cheerful hearts. Lord, help us be good stewards of all you entrust to our care. We pray all these things in Jesus' name.
Thank you.
Children can be dismissed to their kid class downstairs. Get the extra kids in discipleship. We pray for them while they're downstairs studying God's word. While the adults are up here doing the same thing. Today we're going to continue our series we began last week on recharging our spiritual batteries. Last week we looked at Psalm chapter 71. We saw steps that we can take when we are in need of rejuvenation and refreshment in our spiritual walk. We saw that requesting that God be closer to us. We looked at having complete and total reliance on God. We talked about responding in hope. And then we saw the result of having our spiritual lives and spiritual batteries recharged through God's comfort and His peace that He affords us. Today we're going to be looking back to the book of Psalms, and we'll be in Psalm chapter 19 today. Psalm chapter 19, if you want to turn there. What we will see in this text is not only the answers or steps that we can take to experience spiritual refreshment, but we'll also see the cause or the source of what causes us to be in need of spiritual refreshing. But if you found Psalm chapter 19, you can follow along with me as I read. We read the full chapter, and I'll start in verse 1. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth His handiwork. Day unto day uttereth speech, and night unto night showeth knowledge. There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. Their line has gone out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In them hath He set a tabernacle for the sun, which is as a bridegroom coming out of his chamber, and rejoiceth as a strong man to run a race. His going forth is from the end of the heaven, and his circuit to the ends of it, and there is nothing hid from the heat thereof. Verse 7, the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. Verse 10, more to be desired are they than gold, yea, than much fine gold, sweeter also than honey and honeycomb. Moreover, by them is thy servant warned, and in keeping of them there is great reward. Who can understand his errors? Cleanse thou me from secret faults. Keep back thy servant also from presumptuous sins. Let them not have dominion over me. Then shall I be upright, and I shall be innocent from the great transgression. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Father, we just thank you once again for the privilege and opportunity of meeting together. For it's such a blessing to come into your house, to be with your people, to talk to one another, to encourage one another. Lord, I pray that while we're here today, that you will help us to be encouraged, help us to be edified from our time in your word. Lord, I also pray that this will be a time that you will speak to our hearts and challenge us. Lord, I pray that you will speak to our hearts and that your word will fall on hearts that are ready and prepared to receive it. Lord, I pray that you'll help us to not allow ourselves and our lives to walk in and out of this building, in and out of your presence today, and leave unchanged. Lord, I pray that you'll speak to us, challenge us, change us, Lord. Help us be conformed more to the image of your perfect Son, Jesus Christ. I pray all these things in the perfect, precious, and powerful name of Jesus. Amen. This psalm here in Psalm chapter 19 has an ebb and flow to it, which is often a parallel to our lives. It starts off on a very high point, describing the vastness and the greatness of God's glory. Then it goes into warnings about fearing the Lord and the rewards that are attached to doing that. Then it touches on sin and how sin often has a controlling effect on us. And then it concludes with a desire to overcome sin and live our lives in a way that are pleasing to God's sight. So we see kind of the ebb and flow here of Psalm chapter 19, and the reality of it is most of the times, if we're going to step back for a minute and answer, where am I on this chart, so to speak? Am I at a high point right now where the chapter starts, where I'm looking at and appreciating God's glory? Am I in the area of my life where there's sin that is robbing me of my joy, that I have desire to overcome, but I feel the dominion, the controlling authority on my life? Or am I finding my words and my thoughts need to change in order to be pleasing to God? If we're honest, this is similar to how our lives often are. There are times when we are just overtaken, overwhelmed and overjoyed by the greatness of God. And if you're like me, there are times where I am perfectly content to just sit and meditate on God's glory. How good He is. How loving He is. How perfect He is. But then there's other times where I have a really hard time slowing down and focusing on anything other than myself and my own problems. There are times when we struggle with sin. The author here, David, touches on that, and the impact that we can relate to, how it has that binding effect on us. It references here how even though we know His law and His judgments, sometimes we don't fear God the way that we should. And it has an effect on us having our spiritual batteries drained. There are times when we can feel ourselves being tempted to think thoughts, to say things and to act in ways that we know in our heart are not pleasing to God, which lead us to needing our spiritual batteries being recharged. So today we're going to touch on each of these aspects we see in this text and see how we can not only access them through the text, but how we can apply them to our lives to get the refreshing, to get the rejuvenation, to get the recharging that we need spiritually. And we're going to start right at the very beginning of this chapter, which holds the first key to spiritual refreshment that we're going to see. Oftentimes when we start to feel overwhelmed or stressed, when we start to feel anxious or spiritually depleted, it's because we're focusing on ourselves and our own lives more than we are focusing on God. And we see that the first step in our text today to recharging your spiritual batteries is to transition from that way of thinking, to transition from that inward focus on ourselves and our own problems to transition to focusing on God. If you're following along on your bullet, on the back of your bulletin, you'll see the outline for today. And what we see here first is that the first six verses of this chapter focus on the completeness and comprehensiveness of God. Verse 1 references how the heavens declare the glory of God and how the firmament shows His handiwork. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9, Paul writes and says, "Eye hath not seen, and ear has not heard, neither has entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for them to love." The Bible Bible says that heaven is going to be so amazing, so beautiful, so wonderful, that we can't even begin to describe how awesome it's going to be. When you look at the world around us and recognize that God did all this in 6 days, imagine what heaven's going to be like when he's had thousands of years to prepare for us to get there. We get a picture of God's awesomeness. Our eyes have never seen anything so amazing. Our ears have never heard of anything as beautiful. We can't even imagine or picture in our own minds or in our own hearts what God has actually prepared for us. But while we're here, he gives us a little glimpse. He gives us a preview. And how does he do that? Through the handiwork that we're able to observe in the skies. In verse 1 it says, the heavens declare the glory of God, and that firmament, or the expanse of the skies, proclaims the works of his hands. There's something about the sky that I think we'd all agree reveals God's glory in a way unlike anything else. We can look at some beautiful mountains. We can look at some beautiful oceans. And we can be drawn in and appreciate God's glory. It is amazing how awesome he is. But there's something about the sky that helps us to really appreciate how awesome God is. When we consider that astronomers estimate that there are about 100,000 million stars in the Milky Way alone, and millions upon millions of other galaxies that we're not even aware of yet, that we haven't even discovered. And in Psalm chapter 147, verse 4, it says this. It says that God knows the number of the stars, and he calls them all by name. This is where, for me personally, when I consider God, I realize just how amazing he is. I think everybody here knows that I have 3 daughters. And inevitably, you know what happens when I want to call one of them? I call the wrong name. When I want Lexi, I call for Allie. When I want Allie, I end up calling for Eric. I've only got 3 names to choose from, and I still get confused and mess that up. God is the only one who knows how many millions or billions or trillions of stars there are, and he calls them all by the right name every single time. He never gets confused. And verse 2 says, day unto day uttereth the speech, and night unto night showeth knowledge. So even in our limited understanding, our minds can get a glimpse of God's glory, of his perfection, when we behold the natural working order of the world in which we live. The sun comes up in the morning, it sets at night, and when the sun goes down, the stars and the moon come up. There's an undeniable pattern to the world around us that speaks amazingly to the unlimited knowledge and perfection of God. Then verse 3 says that there's no speech nor language where that voice is not heard. Whether you're living here in America, whether you are in Africa, whether you're living in South America, regardless of where you live, we see here that God's handiwork, the vastness of his wonder and creativity, is not limited by geographical boundaries or language barriers. His vastness, his greatness, his magnitude reaches all. But unfortunately, we have a tendency not so much to forget about God's completeness, but we have a tendency to sometimes take it for granted and to not appreciate it the way that we should. Now, we all know the creation story from Genesis, how God literally took a world full of complete nothingness and spoke into the world life and existence. We know how he made the sun, how he made the moon. And we understand in our own minds that we can believe that that's how it happened. But if you keep your spot here in Psalm 19, but turn over to Genesis chapter 1. This is one of my favorite verses in the Bible. It's one of my favorite verses in the Bible because it causes me to pause and think about the unbelievable power and glory of God. And a life that's so busy, it's hard to just kind of take a minute, take a moment to think about God. And if we're going to be honest, sometimes we can just go, go, go. We can run ourselves ragged where we never really stop and think and give God our undivided attention. So So I love verses like this that when I read them, they just stop me dead in my tracks and cause me to pause and turn my focus to God no matter what I'm doing. And verse 16 says this. God made two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night. He made the stars also. I love the colon there towards the end of the verse. So God made two great lights. He made the sun to rule the day and the moon to rule the night. And then after that colon, almost like it's an afterthought, it's like, oh yeah, God made those stars too. Those things that we look up at and we can't number. We can't even we try to appreciate the beauty as best we can. It's almost like an afterthought. God's like, yeah, I did that too. Just so you know, I'll throw that in there. Now, if you ever looked up, and lately we've had some really beautiful, clear nights here, where there's just been no, you can look up in the sky, there's no cloud in sight. And you can see, like, every star just perfectly clear. It's almost like the sky is this big, dark sheet with just holes poked in it, with a flashlight that illuminates the stars. You can see just these perfectly bright stars illuminated against a perfectly dark canvas. And we stop. Even if we're walking across, we look up and we stop what we're doing. And that's an afterthought. God says, oh, yeah, I made those two. I did that. There's a tendency for all of us to, at times, to take God's vastness for granted. Even though we're living in the world that He created, breathing the air that He provided, eating the food that He gives to sustain us, we have a tendency sometimes not to necessarily think, but to act as if somehow we're the focus, or our lives are the focus. We lose sight of the big picture, and we can get so consumed with ourselves and our own lives. And too many times as Christians, we act as if everything in our lives is a big deal, while forgetting that God is the one who created it and gave us it. If you go out in your backyard once the sun has gone down, you look up at the expanse of the sky, try seeing how many different stars you can count. That will remind you of just how vast something about the sky just helps to put that in perspective. I love going to the planetarium up at Corning at the community college. I don't like science. I'm not into astronomy or anything like that, but the planetarium is one of my favorite places in the world to go. Because you can sit there, and even in a controlled environment, it puts into perspective how small I am and how big God is. Now, John said in his gospel, he must increase, I must decrease. And something about envisioning ourselves and compared to God's glory and the sky that He's given us really makes that very clear. About how much bigger this world is than me. How much bigger the world is than the problems I'm facing. How much greater the God that I serve is than any of the problems I'm going through right now. That's the reason why I've always liked telescopes. Something about the sky and stars just makes it so abundantly clear that the world isn't about me. There are a lot more important things happening that are outside my field of vision. And that's not that I'm not important, it's not that you're unimportant, but when we become so focused on ourselves and our own lives, we have a tendency to act as if we're the center of the universe. And our problems, our concerns, our stresses are what gets magnified, instead of God's greatness being magnified. The first step to experience refreshment and recharging your life might be simply to take some time observing and appreciating God's handiwork. Doing so should help put our lives and stresses into proper perspective. Right? Over in Isaiah chapter 55, God says, "For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." God said, "My thoughts are as high above yours as the heavens are above the earth." And we can think about that and think to ourselves, well, I know that's really high, but how much higher is the heaven than the earth? How much higher is God's ways and His thoughts than my ways and my thoughts? Well, the closest star that we have to us is Proxima Centauri. That's 4.24 light years away. A light year is 5.88 trillion miles. So the closest star to us that we can observe with our eye is approximately 25 trillion miles to Earth. The closest star to us is approximately 300,000 times the distance from the Earth to the Sun. So when God tells us that His ways are and His thoughts are above our thoughts, that kind of puts things in perspective. God says, the way you can look at the sun, but the sun, 300,000 times the distance from the Earth to the sun is the closest star that we have to us. So when we recognize that, and we appreciate the completeness and comprehensiveness of God, that's something that's necessary for all of us to do as a way of recharging our spiritual bandwidth. Next, I'd like us to see what often is a source of us needing spiritual refreshment. We're going to look next at the cause. What causes us to become spiritually depleted? What causes our spiritual batteries to run low? We're looking at verses 12 and 13 together, but I'd like to start first in verse 13. Verse 13 says, "Keep thy servant back from presumptuous sins. Let them not have dominion over me." Then in verse 12, "Cleanse thou me from sacred faults." In order to dissect these verses, we need to understand the words presumptuous and secret. Because these are two types of sins that are presented here in this text. And we see here in verse 13, they both have the ability to deflate us and to defeat us spiritually. In verse 13, it uses that word dominion. And that word dominion means that it takes authority. It takes control of us. So we do acknowledge that sin has a tendency to take control and take dominion of our lives. So why is it that we sometimes feel beaten down and despondent and feel like our spiritual batteries are empty? Because there's a very real possibility that your life and your spirit are being affected and impacted by sin. Isaiah chapter 59, verse 2, it says that our iniquities, our transgressions, separate us from God. Now, we used the illustration last week of a power cord. Of taking the charger, plugging one end into the source, the outlet. We talked about last week how God is our outlet. And no matter what we do, until we plug into Him, no energy flows through to the desired end result if we're trying to get charged up. But we think about that in Isaiah chapter 59, verse 2. It says that our sin separates us from God. Now, when I think about that, one illustration I would think of is I remember when our girls were young, just starting to crawl and becoming more mobile. Do you remember that phase of parenthood when everything is, you have to be worried about everything, to get into everything? Well, you go through and you try to baby-proof your house. Mm-hmm. And over the outlets, I don't even know what they're called, but you have a little plastic thing you put in the outlet so they don't shock themselves? That's a barrier to the outlet. So if I were to take my phone and try to plug it in through that barrier, what's going to happen? It's not going to get plugged in. It's not going to happen. No matter, I can try to push through it, I can try to, I might, no matter what I do, there's something that's blocking me from being able to plug into the source to get that power. Well, that little blocker that we put over the outlet, let's equate that with sin. If you go to the Lord and say, "Lord, I need to be refreshed," as long as there is a cover on the outlet, as long as there's sin present there, you can't plug into it. Your sin separates you from God. So when you feel like, man, I'm burnt out, I'm trying to do these things, I don't know what's going on, we need to stop and think, is there some sin that's separating me from God? Because no matter what you try in the flesh, in your own human power, God says, your sin has separated you from me. And it doesn't mean you have to try harder. It doesn't mean you have to try to just push the charger into the wall harder than you did last time. You have to remove the object or the hindrance that's causing the disconnect. We see that here in verses 12 and 13, the reality of sin. We see here that sin is what unplugs us, so to speak, from God. Now note the word there, presumptuous, in our text. Because the word presumptuous, here in context, context in which we're reading it does not mean the same thing that we use it for today. If we were to say that we're presumptuous today, or say that someone is a presumptuous person, it means that they're very forward. They're very impulsive. They presume that they know all the details, and they rush to judgments. That's a presumptuous person. But in our text, the word presumptuous here actually means willful. A presumptuous sin is something that we know is wrong, but we knowingly and willingly do it anyway. We choose to violate something. We choose to violate one of God's commands that we know we should not be doing. And a secret sin or a secret fault, on the other hand, doesn't mean the same thing that we might think either. David here, the author of this psalm, prays and asks God, says, to cleanse him from secret faults. Now, secret in this sense does not mean that there's some sin that only David and God know about that he's able to keep hidden from everybody else's view. Secret here means that David is asking God to forgive him of sins that even he himself isn't aware of yet. And really, these two verses relate and go hand in hand with 1 John 1:9, which says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And what's amazing and what connects these two passages together is that we're told if we confess our sins, well, which sins? Our presumptuous sins. The sins that we know are wrong. The things that we can identify in our lives that we need to repent of. The Bible tells us that when we confess of our known sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us of all our sins, which include our secret sins. Because if we think about it logically, if we knew that something was wrong and needed to be repented of, it wouldn't be a secret to us anymore. It'd be very clear for us to point that out. And here's the part that really matters to us as it pertains to our thought for today. We see that word, dominion. Look down in verse 13. Keep back thy servant also from presumptuous sins. Let them not have dominion over me. We don't talk about this enough because nobody wants to address. It's uncomfortable to address this in our own lives. And the reason why I'm spiritually depleted, the reason why my spiritual batteries aren't charged up, we like to blame that on other people. We like to blame that on other circumstances. We like to blame it on different situations. When we see here, David says, the reason why we're not plugged in, why we're not refreshed spiritually, why we need spiritual refreshment, is because sin is controlling our lives. We see that word dominion. That word dominion means total authority or to be under control. Now think about it spiritually. When you gave your heart to the Lord, you submitted to him, who are we supposed to be under the authority of? Jesus Christ. But when we have known sins in our life that we refuse to repent of, that we refuse to change, we are choosing a new master. We are allowing sin to have dominion over us, rather than our Heavenly Father, who has a rightful place and a rightful claim to our hearts. Hear very clearly in these two verses that as long as there are willful sin in our lives, sin that we know is wrong, but we choose to do it anyway, we are under the power, the dominion of sin. And why does that matter? When we're involved in willful sin, we cannot, as verse 14 says, be upright and innocent before the Lord. This is where the rubber kind of meets the road, and we have to sit here and say, you know what, I'm not an innocent bystander. I'm not just a victim of all these this series of events that's happened to me. I am right now in my spiritual life. I cannot say that I am innocent and upright before the Lord if I have unconfessed sin in my life. So why is it so many Christians live their lives spiritually unplugged, needing a spiritual battery? Oftentimes they don't want to admit or confront the sin that's actually in their life. If we're going to be honest, it's a lot easier to blame other people for our spiritual problems. It's easier to blame other people for our circumstances. When David at least had the spiritual discernment to say, you know what, the problem I have in my life is because I have sin that take control. I have sins that have dominion. So when we think about that word dominion, have total control. That means that when they're sin in our lives, it changes the way we think. It changes the way we talk. It changes the way we act. We mentioned earlier that Isaiah chapter 59, verse 2 makes it clear that our sin separates us from God and creates a disconnect in our relationship with Him. So this is where we have to be very real and very honest with ourselves and realize that if we feel like our spiritual batteries are low, or we feel like we're completely dead or burned out spiritually, we need to consider that it might be due to the presence of sin in our lives. When we understand that sin separates us from God, if we can identify presumptuous sins, willful sin in our lives that we have not repented of, that we have not turned away from, it's easy for us to diagnose and assess why we feel so depleted spiritually. We're not plugged in to our Heavenly Father. And we can't be, as long as there's sin present in our life that we're allowing to go unchecked and undealt with. If I can put it this way, if you look at your life and identify the attitudes of pride or anger or hate, if you can identify a lack of patience, lack of forgiveness, lack of faith. And you can yourself identify sin in your life that you have not yet repented and turned from. Even though you know it shouldn't be there, you've already got your answer on why you're feeling spiritually run down. Why your spiritual batteries need refreshing. But what we look at next gives us hope on how we can not only identify which sins in our life need to be addressed, but also how we can obtain the wisdom that we need to act in such a way to maintain fellowship with the Lord so we don't go through spiritual disconnection. We've seen the comprehensiveness of God. We've seen the cause of our disconnection from Him. And next we're going to look at conversion. Verse 7 says, "The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul." Now the law of the Lord is very simply God's Word. I'm not a big guru when it comes to technology. I appreciate technology and the way that it can be a blessing to us. But I'm far from being up to date on the most groundbreaking technology and different gadgets and tablets and things like that. But one thing that I do know from my own experience is that on my laptop and my phone, there are upgrades that pop up every few months. Every year there's a new model of a smartphone that's released. There are recalls due to malfunctions or software errors. But what we see here is that this is not the way that God designed our spiritual life. You don't have to upgrade your faith every few months. There's no new model of salvation every year. There's no new release on what God wants or expects from us. We simply need to be plugged into His Word, and He will reveal to us how He wants us to live. Notice what it says about God's Word there in verse 7. It says it is perfect. It never needs to be updated. Never needs to be modified. It's without error, it's precise, it's perfect. And what does it say next? That God's Word converts. That word convert means that it changes us and transforms us. If you're feeling spiritually burned out, spiritually deflated, in need of recharging, the place to start we see here in our text is by connecting to God's Word. I won't ask for a show of hands, but if you feel a disconnect in your relationship with God, if you just don't feel as connected to Him as you have in the past, I would ask you, how connected are you to God's Word? Just as we saw earlier, if there's any willful sin in your life that you're not repenting and turning away from, you're not going to be connected to God the way that you should. And you're not going to be connected to God's Word. And if you're not connected to God's Word, you won't be connected to that perfect source of refreshing of what you're looking for. If you're not reading God's Word, missing out on the connection that will change the way you view everything. Again, look at how powerful God's Word is. Verse 7 says that it converts or it changes the soul. At the end of the verse, it references converting the mind when it says making wise the simple. Did you know that there are some conclusions that you will come to on your own? Some decisions that you'll make on your own that might seem really smart to you, that until you're connected to God's Word, you won't realize that wasn't that wise. It's amazing how real and relevant God's Word is. But if you're not connected to it, it says you won't be wise. The word simple there at the end of the verse means foolish. Essentially, what we see is that until we're connected with God's word, our thoughts and our decisions have a tendency to lean towards foolishness. But when we're connected to God's word, our foolishness is then converted to wisdom through the connection that we have through God's word. God's word changes the way that we view our circumstances. God's word changes the way we view the world. God's word changes the way that we view what happens in our lives. And as the text continues, we see that being connected to God's word converts our soul and our mind, but it also affects our heart and our eyes. And we see that in verse 8. In verse 8, we see enlightened eyes. So what is that? What if on the opposite end of that, if God's word enlightens our eyes, what are our eyes like if we're not reading God's word? They're dark. We're uninformed. Then we see, the end of verse 8, we also see a rejoicing heart. If we want refreshing in our lives, we see that being connected to God's word brings about that rejoicing heart. No matter what area of your spiritual life it is that needs refreshing, if emotionally your heart is heavy and burdened, if worry and stress are leaving you in need of recharging, if you're anxious and in need of clarity about decisions you have to make, your heart can be converted. Your heart can be changed to rejoicing. Your eyes can be changed from confused and confounded to clarity and enlightenment, but not until you connect to God's word. And His word working in and through you will convert your entire being. We see the soul, mind, eyes, and heart. But again, you've got to be plugged in to God's word. We've seen the comprehensiveness of God, the causes of our disconnect from Him, the conversion that takes place when we connect to His word. And finally, today we're going to focus on consistency. Verse 14 says, "Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer." We look at the greatness of God and we see the impact that sin has on our relationship with Him. We've seen how powerful God's word is. But if you only think about God's greatness every now and then, if you only get serious about confessing and confronting sin in your life now, but you don't make it a continual practice going forward, if you jump in and out of reading God's word, it makes it very clear you're not going to experience the refreshing or recharging in your spiritual life you desire. Verse 14, you'll notice two key words here that are very important to understanding this text. You notice the words let and be. And the reason those two words are so important is because they're both in the present tense. It denotes continually letting our thoughts and letting our words constantly being acceptable to God. And the only way that can happen is by being consistent in the steps we've already looked at. The only way that we can ascribe to what verse 14 says is by being consistent in what the previous parts of the chapter tell us to do. If you look at verse 14, we can't ensure that the words of our mouth and the meditation of our thoughts or our heart are going to be acceptable in the Lord's sight until we've made it a priority to consistently do what He tells us to do. What we see here is an effort made in a continual process that involves consistently allowing ourselves to focus on the vastness and comprehensiveness of God instead of focusing on ourselves. Consistently searching our hearts to identify and repent of sins that separate us from God and removing them. Consistently connecting with God through His word and allowing Him to convert and change our thoughts, allowing Him to change our words, allowing Him to change our actions. And that consistency leads us to remaining connected. And when we live these truths out, when we live these steps out in our lives consistently, our spiritual batteries will remain charged. We look there at verse 14. Let's look at it one more time. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength, my redeemer. When we think about that, what a blessing that would be if all the word to thee ever said. Praise the Lord. Can you imagine living a life where the meditations of your heart, every thought that passes through your mind is acceptable in God's sight? It's hard to fathom. The reason why it's so hard for us to fathom is because oftentimes we don't fathom God's greatness. We don't address sin in our lives. And we don't connect to God's word. If we did those things consistently, the way that God tells us to hear his word, imagine the spiritual refresh that could take place simply by having those negative and critical thoughts removed. By having those hurtful, the words that you don't intend to say, by having them removed. We'll say, how can I refrain from saying things that I know I shouldn't say out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks? When God's word gets into your heart, it will change what comes out of your mouth. When God's word gets into your heart, it will change what goes through your mind. So what we need to do is, you'll see these commercials with these get rich quick thing. This isn't a get spiritual quick scheme. This is a get spiritual consistency. You can't just leave here today and say, you know what, I'm going to read my Bible today and then all my problems are going to go away. I'm going to think about God today and all my problems. I'm going to address sin today in my life and I'm going to somehow experience a spiritual refreshing. Refreshing is a constant, continual part of your spiritual life. It can't just be a one day thing. It has to be lived out day after day, month after month, moment by moment. If we're going to do it, let the words of our mouth and the meditation of our heart be acceptable in us. I think that's what God wants from us. I think he wants children where he can look at and say, I'm pleased with those thoughts. I'm pleased with those meditations. I'm pleased with those reactions. I'm pleased with that person. But how do we get to that point where we can be pleasing God's sight? We have to go through all these steps consistently and apply to our lives. Again, there's nothing really flashy about these steps. But making the right decision over and over and over and over again lays the groundwork for our spiritual batteries to not only get refreshed now, but to stay plugged into God's word so we can be more fruitful, more profitable Christians for him going forward. With every head bowed and our eyes closed. Holy Spirit spoke to your heart today. And you know what? I understand that God made the world. I know the creation story. But if I'm going to be honest, there's a part of my life that's so focused on myself, so focused on my own problems, where I spend the majority of my time thinking about myself. And I don't really devote enough time. I don't intentionally carve out time to just sit and appreciate and think about the wonders of the God who created me. If it's your prayer today, just become more calm in your spirit. To allow yourself to focus more on God and his goodness than on your current life situation and trials. If that's your prayer today, just slip your hand up and pray again. Now seal his hands and take down your wrist. Maybe if God spoke to your heart about the cause of spiritual disconnection, which we see as sin. Maybe there's something in your life that you know and say, I know that's wrong. It shouldn't be there, but I haven't taken steps to really eradicate. I'm going to be honest, I haven't really repented. I haven't addressed it. Maybe there's some sin in your heart now that's been nagging and lingering for years. And today's the day that you recognize in order to have your spiritual batteries refreshed, in order to stay in the connection with God that he desires you to have, it's time to deal with those sins. Now, there are some presumptuous sins we saw, but there are some secret sins too. If there's some sins that the Lord has laid on your heart that he wants you to deal with today, I bet your prayer will pray with you about that too. So, yeah. And as you seal sins, you can take them down and you raise them. Maybe the Lord spoke to your heart today about being plugged into his word. You want your mind to be converted. You want your eyes, your thoughts, your heart to be converted. But in order to do that, you really need to be plugged into God's word. If it's your birthday, to be more consistent. And not just reading God's word as some something you can check off the list of what you did for today, but to be looking for it, really to be the source of your refreshing, be the source of your strength you need to get through each day, to live life that is pleasing Him. That's your prayer today. Amen. Just feel His hands. You can take the back and raise them. Maybe let's talk to your heart today about consistency. Maybe you're going to say, you know, there are times when I do think about I do sit and reflect about His goodness and His awesomeness. Now, there are times when I do address sin in my life. There are times when I do read my Bible, but if I'm going to be honest, I'm just not as consistent as I need to be. I kind of jump in and out of my Bible reading. I don't really address the sins the way I should. I allow myself to get overburdened by worry and fear of my own life instead of focusing on God. That's your prayer today, that you've got to something to be more consistent in carrying out these steps that you know that you're already doing in your life that you know are so essential. Let your prayers say we're praying about that too. That was still saying. Take them down after this. This moment we're going to have a time of invitation. We don't have any music today, but if the Lord spoke to your heart, if you'd like to do business with the Lord right where you're seated, or if you'd like to come to the altar will be open. Lord, we just thank you once again for your word. Lord, we thank you for this song. Man who, in your own words, was a man after your own heart. Lord, I pray that you'll help us to follow the example of this man today, one who took time to acknowledge your awesomeness, your completeness. Lord, I thank you for the world around us and how it draws our attention to you. Lord, I pray that you'll help us to not just give you glancing attention, but Lord, to have live our lives focused on your glory, your majesty, and your greatness. Lord, I pray for those that raise their hands today about sin in their lives. Lord, we all have sin. Lord, I pray you'll help us to deal with it the way that we should. Lord, there are some presumptuous sins, some things that we have known have been displeasing you for a very long time that have gone unchecked and undealt with in our lives. I pray that today, Lord, the altar here, or the altar of our own hearts, Lord, we will deal with these sins today. Lord, I pray for those that are looking for conversion in their hearts and minds. Lord, we help them to do that through plugging into your word, through reading your word, studying your word, and expecting you to guide them. Guide us through these difficult times, these difficult trials. Give us the wisdom that we need that we can only get from your word. Lord, I pray that you'll help us to all do all these things consistently. Lord, we know that the world around us is difficult. There's trials, there's challenges. But spiritually, Lord, it can be different. It doesn't have to be a spiritual roller coaster with highs and lows, Lord. We can be consistent. We can be plugged into you. We can be growing. We can be making a priority of the things in our lives that you tell us to make a priority of. And as a result, Lord, we can live a life where our spiritual batteries are charged up. We can be spiritually refreshed, regardless of the circumstances that are going on around us. Everybody help us to be consistent.